call this meeting to order on this day, Monday, March 13th, 2017. If Clerk Kornacki could please call the roll for us tonight.
Trustee Aiello. Trustee Bolfus.
Here.
Trustee Kazone.
Here.
Trustee Case.
Here.
Trustee Taglia.
Here.
Trustee Wagner.
Here.
President Bullwinkle.
Here. Could all please rise for the pledge. I'll lead us in the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Y'all can remain standing for one more second. Trustee Wagner would like to lead us in the prayer tonight.
Thank you, Madam President.
You're welcome.
Heavenly Father, we come to you today asking for your guidance, wisdom, and support as we begin this meeting. Help us to engage in meaningful discussion, allow us to grow closer as a group, and nurture the bonds of community. Fill us with your grace, Lord God, as we make decisions that might affect the residents, staff, businesses, surrounding communities, and all those that enter the village of Villa Park. And continue to remind us that all we do here today, all that we accomplish, is for the pursuit of truth, for the greater glory of you, and for the service of humanity. We ask these things in your name. Amen.
Amen. Okay, item number 3 on the Committee of the Whole is amendments to the Committee of the Whole agenda. Does anybody have any amendments to the Committee of the Whole agenda? Okay, seeing none, we're going to flip over to item number 4. Consider resolution of the Village of Villa Park, DuPage County, Illinois, authorizing the acceptance of a proposal from Call 1 of Chicago, Illinois, for a ShoreTel voiceover internet protocol phone system for approximately 128 phone sites through the Suburban Purchasing Cooperative with lines and usage charges not to exceed $129,643 in the first year. And Chairman.
Thank you, Your Honor. The current phone system utilized by village staff is aging and varies between sites. Village staff is seeking to upgrade the current 7-site phone system to a networked voice over internet protocol, also known as VoIP, phone system that will consist of approximately 128 phone and data connections in the amount of $88,796. Village staff recommends that Call 1 of Chicago, Illinois be granted a contract for the service as the company is a preferred vendor registered with the DuPage Mayors and Managers Conference and has offered a discount on current line and usage charges. Call 1's anticipated line and usage charges are expected to be $40,847 for the first year. The Call 1 discount will result in an estimated annual savings to the village of $28,660. And as a result of the savings, the cost of the VoIP system will be recouped in approximately 3 years. Funds for the VoIP system and usage charges have been budgeted within the 2017-2018 fiscal year. And Your Honor and Board and folks in the audience at home, staff did review the phone system late last week. It's very comprehensive. The phone system we have now is aging, obsolete. We're on a month-to-month contract. We're ready to upgrade. It's much needed. Some of the equipment we have now, we cannot or barely find replacement parts. So at this time, we believe this is one of the best systems out there, and we can recoup such savings that it'll be paid for in 3 years easily. And Your Honor and Board, we do have our IT manager, Brian Sawyer, here this evening with Call 1 executives to answer any questions that we might have.
All right. So would Brian like to come up and talk a little bit more? Where are you? Right. I saw you. There you are. I saw you earlier. Would you like to come up and say a few more things? A few more words about it?
Yeah, sure. I'm just here if anyone has any questions. We currently have 3 PRIs coming into the village. We have a lot of POTS lines, I think maybe 60 or so POTS and Centrix lines. Like Manager Keener said, they're on a month-to-month pricing structure. With this voice over IP system, we can eliminate probably 60 to 70% of these lines. We have to keep some for obviously elevator systems, backup systems, because every location has to have a redundant for E911, for if a link goes down, if our network goes down, we always have to have connectivity for the calling. But we still will realize significant savings by going to this new system because of these old antiquated lines. I have used Call One previously and found that they were a wonderful vendor. I work with a lot of vendors, and in the last 15, 16 years, they were one of the top vendors I've worked with. Just professional, they knew exactly what to do, they were right on top of everything, and they're part of the Suburban Purchasing Cooperative, mm-hmm. so we get an excellent price. We're not taxed on our phone bills, which we currently mm-hmm. were, because we're tax exempt. So just right there, the savings alone is huge. So anything else? I won't get too technical.
Right.
But if anyone has any questions, let me know.
Okay. I'm going to put it out to the public first. Any questions and comments from the public? Come on up, Cheryl. You know the drill. Yes, so make sure you sign your name on the piece of paper. We'll give you 3 minutes to ask your questions about this. Keep an eye on you. Okay. What's on your mind, Cheryl?
Cheryl Tucker, 434 South Cornell. We have seven sites right now. Is that correct, Rich?
That's
we
correct.
Have seven sites. And you're saying that we approximately need 123 phone sites and data right now?
It's about 128 lines and with data connection.
So that's lines and data. What do we have right now with the seven sites?
Pretty, Brian, you may have to answer that one. I don't know how many.
That is a straight one-to-one replacement. We have 128 phones.
Excuse me, you have to come to the mic for the public.
All right, the only buildings that are not included on this are some of our buildings down the street. The garage, I think, has one phone. Another parks building has two phones. Those can be added at a later date. We just did not figure into that cost yet. So we're kind of, getting all the infrastructure in place and then assuming those phones later on, they'd just be separate phone purchases because all the network would be in place.
So we're basically going one-to-one?
Yeah, we have 128 phones currently. We'll replace those with 128 new phones. Majority of those phones, we have like 46 of them just in the police department. So, between that and Village Hall, that is a bulk of all of our phones.
We need that many phones. Mm-hmm. You check them all.
I've went to every location. I had to count how many phones we have.
So we actually need 128 phones.
I believe so, yes.
And what are we doing with the old wiring system? The old system? Because you can't use it.
We cannot use it. It's built into the building, so that's category 3 wire. It's just regular phone jack. It's going to stay in the building. We are saving money, actually, by using these phones. They call what's daisy chaining. We would have to run a separate wire to each location, 128 runs. It would be so expensive. So what we're doing is we're utilizing the existing wiring that's at every desk, and we're plugging that wire into the phone. Another wire comes out, and it goes right to the computer.
So we
already have wire. It's already wired for every location.
So we're not taking the wiring out. You're not charging us for removing what's already
here? Nope. Okay. We're using existing cabling, so it's going to save us a ton of money. Okay. It's using just the computer wire since it's running over the same network. Yep. Thank you.
Anybody else from the public regards to this item? Okay, seeing none. Anybody from the board?
Just a quick question. How easy is it to upgrade the system? We'll pay for it in 3 years, and in 3 years it'll be obsolete probably. But being, a VoIP system, I imagine it's pretty easy to just upgrade through the computer system.
It is. Phone systems are really designed for 15 to 20 year lifespan. The software is an update. We have maintenance on this. It would be a software update that I could do, that Call One could do. I could just call them and say, do it, or I've done it before. But yeah, it's just software, and it's actually going to be installed. We'll have a physical main box, and then we'll have the voice is going to be loaded on one of our servers here. So yeah, I have full control over it. I will be the administrator of it. But yes, it's very easy to update. And that'll, of course, include new features if they come out, new revisions, bugs and fixes. So there will be several throughout the year, little updates.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
All right, thanks.
Yep.
Okay. Anybody else on the board? Trustee Wagner.
Just the actual hardware, the phone on the desk, that's not going to change at all, is it? It's just going to be, or are they getting new phones?
Yes, correct. We have to get new phones. Our current phones are not compatible.
Okay.
There are straight analog phones. So, yeah, in order to get any kind of voiceover, I mean, it's not even if it was with call one, we would have to replace the phones.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
Thank you.
Anybody else? Because they both
I'm not an expert on this, so I'll leave it to you, but is there any security concerns that we have to worry about or that are being covered?
As far as...
I don't know.
What happens is
somebody listening to my phone call?
No, it's a good question. What happens is our network is segregated. It's divided. It's what they call VLANing. It's kind of putting up walls between your phone call, between the voice traffic and the data traffic.
Okay.
They're totally separate. Even though they ride on the same wire, they cannot see each other. They cannot interfere with each other or nothing. So what we do is we do that because we want voice traffic to take priority. Because if you get a lot of data through a pipe, you'll get choppy phone calls. Because the voice has to come through crystal clear. So that'll always take priority over someone saving a file, browsing the internet. Now, not that they'll notice, but the micro milliseconds that it takes to get there, we always want to prioritize the voice traffic. So that's what we have to do, is we have to channel it off from the data separately. Using the same wire, no one knows, no one's the wiser. But on the back end of it, that's how you have to build the infrastructure out to maximize the quality and the security of it. Yep.
Thanks.
Trustee Case.
So pretty easy. We're moving into the 20th century.
Yes.
Slowly but surely.
Yes.
Easy enough.
I have a question.
Okay. Trustee Tang.
Yeah, I have a question about the computers. Is it one phone per computer, or can you get more than one phone line through each PC?
Actually, every phone can handle up to 8 lines. We have one wire and we're having one phone per desk or per location.
Sure.
But every phone, since it is voice over IP, they're capable of grabbing actually 8 lines at a time.
So you have more capacity if you need it.
I can start a conference call in my office with up to 10 people in conference mode right on my phone.
Wow.
There's a lot of new features that we don't have now. I mean, it's so easy to start a conference. We'll have 4-digit dialing throughout the whole village. So if I wanted to call up CRB or North Avenue, I could just dial 4 digits and it'll ring. Right now we don't have that. We have to dial a whole 10-digit number to get somebody. Everyone will have a software client loaded on their machine, which they can access voicemail, they can dial, they can do anything. They don't even have to touch the phone. There's a full bunch of features just on the software.
Yeah, I have that at work. It shows on Outlook, will show you who's calling.
Correct.
And you can leave voicemails in the email.
Yep. And it syncs with our calendar, so if you're in a meeting, it automatically goes to voicemail. There's just a whole bunch of features.
I know the system I use, it. It's very good.
Yep.
So, yeah.
Anybody else? Didn't we have a phone failure recently?
I believe so.
Yeah, so...
I'm not sure what exactly it was. Janet would know more than I.
I guess my point is, we could really use a new system.
Oh,
we can't,
yes.
You know, we can't keep having these phone system breakdowns.
No.
Yeah.
They get to a point where, you just can't find parts for them. You can't find technicians that are trained in them. When they get to 15, 20 years old, it's you're shopping for parts on eBay and hoping someone can put it in.
Oh, jeez.
You know?
Yeah.
That's just what's going on, yeah.
Getting up to the current century, it'll
yep.
be good. So, okay.
Yep.
Anybody else? We all good? Okay. Roll call vote.
Okay. Trustee Bolthus?
Yes.
Trustee Case?
Yes.
Trustee Cazone?
Yes.
Trustee Wagner?
Yes.
Trustee Taglia?
Yes.
President Bowinkle?
Yes. Okay. Item number 5 on the Committee of the Whole, discussion only, fiscal year 2017-2018 proposed budget operations.
Thank you, Your Honor. Prior to the February 27, 2017 board meeting, members of the board were provided with copies of a draft of the fiscal year 2017-2018 budget. The village will begin review of the proposed fiscal year 18, May 1st, 2017 through April 30th, 2018 budget with a discussion of the main operations of the village. This is the first budget workshop with subsequent workshops planned on March 15th to complete discussions of operations and the capital improvement plan. We anticipate a budget hearing and the first reading of the budget ordinance on April 10th with adoption on April 24th for a May 1st, 2017 fiscal year start. And Your Honor and Board, I believe during the last meeting on February 27th, Trustee Aiello did ask a couple of questions about the pensions, fire, police pensions. Mm-hmm. So I believe Director Wachtel provided the board with much needed information.
Yeah.
Containing the actuarial studies and some history of public safety pensions, et cetera. So at the conclusion of the budget presentation this evening, if and when anyone would desire to talk about the public pensions, we can certainly do that. Thank you, Your Honor.
Okay. With that, Kevin, I can tell you're very anxious to get this underway.
I am.
So, are we? Oh. Well, maybe we can start with kind of an overview of what we want to cover tonight, and then
sure.
We can get into the presentation on the screen then.
Where we are tonight, projector's coming back up.
So okay.
We'll be right. We're in one more step in our annual budget process. We had the department heads provide budget requests starting in November. So we compiled that through December and January, and had several budget meetings throughout those months to come up with a proposed budget. We met with the village manager and all the department heads several times, and that's how we arrived at the proposed budget, which we distributed at the prior to the last board meeting. So tonight's our discussion talking about the operating budget, the operating side of the budget. And this coming Wednesday, in 2 days, then Vitas will be up here talking about the capital side of the budget, where he'll review the capital spending for this year and for the next several years. But tonight's the operating budget, and then in a few weeks we'll have the public hearing and adoption of the ordinances at subsequent meetings. But we wanted to get this going earlier in March so that we have plenty of time to discuss and make adjustments or answer questions that any board members or anybody that may have regarding the budget. So I'm going to start just talking about some general highlights of our spending plan, our budget. This budget continues a large investment in streets and infrastructure. That's been a theme for the past several years, especially with the bond funds from the road referendum and other sources. We continue to spend our non-home rule sales tax and other sources for streets and whatnot. We continue an investment in our equipment. That includes a variety of operating departments, including IT, as we were just talking about the phone system and different softwares and things like that for ongoing operational efficiencies. So we continue to focus on effective and efficient services, trying to do more with less monetarily and just efficiency for staff, allocating staff time, including the phone system, the permitting software, CityView. We're continuing to work and implement that program. As always, we are watching Springfield to identify potential revenue changes or any changes that could affect how we operate the village on an ongoing basis. The budget maintains our existing services. Nothing is cut from this year's budget. Continued investment in our swimming pools, community garden plots, tree trimming. We do have tree trimmings and removals still in the budget, looking for some planting as well. We did get a donation for some tree planting, bike and pedestrian path, and we are continuing an economic development focus. And as you see some of the numbers, that has really paid off. We've got some good sales tax numbers coming in. So this is a snapshot of total revenues by fund. So we have different funds for different purposes. Our main operating fund is our corporate fund. Sometimes I refer to that as the general fund or the corporate fund. That's about 42% of all the revenues that come into the village. Other large funds include our water and wastewater funds, funded mostly by user fees, as you'll see at a moment. So if you look on this is all of our revenues village-wide by source. So in the upper right corner, it includes our property tax and our sales taxes that make up over a quarter of all of our revenues that come into the village. We have state-shared revenues and other taxes as well. But the other largest section is that orange slice. Other largest section that's specifically identified is that orange slice, which is charges for services, and that includes things like water and wastewater usage charges and recreation program fees in those particular funds. So this is looking at the expenditure side of the equation, total expenditures or expenses by fund. And as you can imagine, our main operating account, main operating fund is the corporate fund, and about 38% of all of our spending village-wide. Again, as you'd expect, our water and wastewater fees, our funds also have a sizable amount of spending. But down that orange slice down at the bottom is our street improvement fund. And that includes both our operating expenses and the street improvement, which is very, very minor, but mostly the capital investment. And again, spending down the bond proceeds from the referendum. Overall, it's about almost $58 million worth of spending village-wide. This is taking a look at how we're spending our dollars, the types of expenditures by source. The upper right corner is salaries and wages at about a third of all of our spending. And that big orange slice on the left, we are actually spending more in capital than we are in salaries and wages, which is not typical for a government, but because we are spending so much on their bond proceeds for our streets, that is larger and has been larger the past couple of years. And will continue until those projects are done. So here's a snapshot of our current fiscal year. That's the fiscal year we're in right now that's going to end on April 30th. We have a projected fund balance of just over $9.1 million. And if we calculate the number of days of fund balance on hand, that's about 155 days. This is all based on numbers through the end of January. So, of course, we're going to have some more activity over the next couple of months that will refine that. But that's where we're looking as of right now. Our target is about 90 days of fund balance on hand. We had a low of about 52 days right at the low point of the Great Recession. This year's projection calls for a net gain of about $860,000. That is much better budget performance than we had planned. And that's because our revenues are higher by about 1.5%. And our expenditures are a little bit lower by about 2.3%. And again, this is still projected. We will look at the end of the year, see if the other operating funds need some transfers to help shore them up. But that will come as the end of the year comes to a close. So now this is the budget that we're actually talking about. We are projecting that at the end of the budget year, we will still have about a $9.1 million surplus, and that's about 147 days fund balance on hand. That's a little bit lower because the operating expenses are just a little bit higher, so it changes the math just a bit. So about almost $23 million in revenue, and if you put the operating expenses of $20.9 million and the transfers for capital and operating, it's about even, but we do have a budget that is surplus in the capital fund by several thousand dollars. So we look at the corporate fund. This is the general fund, the main operating fund. About $22.8 million, and that's about an $820,000 increase from the fiscal 17 budget that we're in. Fiscal 16, the actual was about $21.8 million, so it is growing by a little bit each year. The revenue budget, the specific line items where we're seeing some increases, sales tax is definitely increasing. It's up by over $117,000 from last year. And again, this is from our economic development efforts. We've got a lot of stuff going on. We've got some businesses that will continue to be opening soon up on North Avenue, so that and other areas of the village, that is definitely a benefit to us. Red light cameras, some of that's offset by fees, but that is improving, and utility taxes. Some areas where we're seeing some lower revenues are police fines, state income tax, that's kind of a moving target, and also grants, but that's just as a placeholder for programs that we are hoping to get. Sometimes we budget for things that we know we're going to get. When we're talking about the corporate fund, though, it's kind of a placeholder for things that are in the pipeline, and those don't always come to fruition. But we try. We certainly do try. Other changes and things that we see every year, minor changes, but things to mention, garbage collection is tracked through the corporate fund. We do have definitely increases in our collections and debt recovery. We're looking at some ways to do different collections and debt recovery. We're using the state program that's been very helpful and successful. And again, with the economic development, that's been a very important part of our growth. So here's a pie chart of our revenues. We started fiscal 15, our actuals were about $20.7 million for revenues. And this year in fiscal 18, it's about $22.8 million. So it's a nice schedule of growth each year. Year over year, we're seeing a little bit more. Nothing too dramatic and out of the ordinary, so that's a good good trend to see. On the expense side, we do have a balanced corporate fund budget. We've moderated some of our capital equipment transfers to other funds, our capital transfers to other funds. And again, it maintains our current service levels. We're continuing our priority initiatives, street maintenance, of course, tree trimming and removals, economic development. These are all areas of focus. We're continuing our operating transfer for our parks and recreation funds, and as well as our swimming pool funds as community amenities. So here's the 4-year trend of our corporate fund expenditures. In fiscal 15, we had about $19.7 million, and that's grown gradually every year to about $22.8 million. Fiscal 18 budget as proposed right now. We do have some transfers that come out of the corporate fund. We have some funds that pretty much their only source of revenue is transfers from the corporate fund. Things like the equipment replacement fund, although they do get money from other funds as well, and building improvement funds. We got about a $1.1 million transfers to those funds for various governmental purposes throughout the village. And again, we're projecting 147-day fund balance on hand at the end of the fiscal 18 budget.
And if I can just ask a quick question there. We're mandated by the state of Illinois to have at least a minimum of 90 days. Is that correct?
The GFOA has a recommendation that that you have a fund balance policy and have a substantial amount of reserves. We've determined that 90 days is a comfortable level for us. The bare minimum that the GFOA recommends is 2 months. And that a lot of times depends on the reliability and consistency of the revenues that you have. So if you have if you're just a billing for water bills every month and you're getting money in every month, then you can then you got a more consistent form of revenue. We're reliant on some things that are very cyclical. Property taxes, we have two spikes throughout the year. So in 2 months we have very high surpluses, and the other months we don't, because we don't have that revenue source. It's very high spikes and cycles. So we want to have at least a 3-month fund balance on hand, a very minimum of 3 months. We'd like to have 4. Mm-hmm. Have that on hand so that we can weather those peaks and troughs. So it all depends on the circumstances, but that's our recommendation. So when we're looking at the corporate fund or operations, here are some things that we are specifically watching. There's been a proposal to change the healthcare system, but we don't know what's going to happen. So we continue to look at healthcare costs. Those can grow very quickly over time. Pension costs are a huge driver, a huge cost increase for us. We do get an increase in our property tax levy, but it's more than eaten up by the additional contribution that we are required to make to our police and fire pension programs. Legislative changes, that's one of our biggest threats. It's one of the biggest things that we talk about every single week in our staff meeting, what's going on in Springfield. State shared revenue, always at risk. Property tax freeze, we've seen a dozen different proposals. There are probably more than that, and who knows what, if anything, will come of that. But I'm guessing something. Who knows what that will be, but we continue to look at that. And proposals to eliminate or scale back our photo enforcement efforts, that's an important program for us. So just to summarize where we are, our revenues continue our overall increases. Bottom line, our revenues are growing at a gradual rate, a steady rate, which is good. Sales activity, consumer behavior within Villa Park is really growing, and that is a great response to our economic development efforts. I think we've been well positioned for all of that. Definitely positive results. We've got about 147 days fund balance planned to be on hand at the end of this budget year, fiscal 18 budget year. And many funds have a positive fund balance with spending some fund balance. But that's with pre-funded capital investment, things like our roads and our other infrastructure that are currently planned for this coming year. Again, this addresses some of our capital needs. There's always more capital needs that we have. We are trying to take an approach that is within our means, but we're doing things to improve the community, we think. And it continues funding for major initiatives that have been a focus of the village for several years. We're continuing to focus those and maintain our current services. We have a perspective of fiscal responsibility. We want to maintain our current service level, current service levels. We're always looking to contain our costs, have our costs not increase more than they have to over time. So we're looking for ways to provide other services, like using a new phone system to lower our ongoing operating costs by thousands of dollars a year. Sometimes it takes a little bit of a capital investment to make that happen. We continue to look at efforts that way. We're always talking within the village, within our departments, how can we work together to save dollars as opposed to everyone working independently. So interdepartmental cooperation and intergovernmental, so working with our neighbors and other agencies to make our dollars go farther. Key investments in software and technology for effective and efficient operations. Not only is it better for our staff, but as a customer service perspective, that's what our residents and our customers want. We want to be able to provide them with the best customer service that we can. And we continue to implement the issues that have been identified in the strategic plan. So that's the end of my prepared remarks. Certainly would be would like to answer any questions that you all have. It's been a lot of time and effort to put the budget together. Manager Keener has had more budget meetings than I have, but certainly department heads have been put through the ringer several times, and so I appreciate their effort. I appreciate working with Rich to get the budget to a place where it's at now. I think we're in a good spot. So.
Okay, I'll open it up. Anybody have any questions on the board?
Oh, I have one question.
Last slide,
Kevin. You intergovernmental opportunities. What intergovernmental opportunities do we have?
When I think of intergovernmental opportunities, it's everything. If we're going to be looking at a piece of equipment, talking to our neighbors, hey, do you have this piece of equipment? We have purchased some of our equipment used from other agencies. We are looking at the Suburban Purchasing Cooperative. Things like that where it just makes more sense to work together. Sometimes maybe we need something for a year or we need it a couple of times a year, work together on a shared piece of equipment, things like that.
Gotcha.
Are you good?
Okay.
Trustee Case.
You said about eliminating the photo cameras up there or something, or cutting back on them?
Yes.
Is that by the street lights or stoplights?
Yes.
Same ones?
Yes. The photo enforcement cameras, yes. There's been a number of different proposals. Mm-hmm. Some have limited, some just in DuPage County, some just neighboring, along neighboring jurisdictions, and some were all together. I mean, who knows what's going to happen. Mm-hmm.
And nice job, too. You and staff, all right?
Thank you.
Real nice job. That's it.
Okay. Anybody else? Trustee Aiello, hi.
Who does our investing for our funds for fire pension, police pension?
Okay. For the fire pension fund, they have one investment advisor who was hired about a year or so ago. That's Sawyer Falduto Asset Management. So they just came on about a year ago. For the police pension fund, they have two different investment firms. One is Sawyer Falduto, and the other is MB Financial Bank. So they have their portfolio split between the two investment advisors. And they have had them for a couple of years, just a little bit longer than the fire pension.
Do you know what kind of investments they're actually in?
They're all in different mixes of portfolios or more. I can get that for you, what their specific current asset breakdown is. Yeah, but they invest more in equities. Some have some international stocks and some emerging market stocks and things along those lines.
Okay, so they're invested across a broad range of
vehicles. Yes.
Absolutely.
Were we negative in 16 on both funds?
Yes, in both funds as of the measurement date, which was April 30th, both funds had a negative investment return. The target for both of them is 7%, so that's really what we're shooting for with both of the pension funds. That was a very bad day in the markets to have that be your measurement date. On the upside, I know that the fire pension, I don't have the latest information on the police pension, but for the fire pension this past year, or since May 1, has earned about $1 million in investment return. So there has been some rebound definitely in that particular fund. It doesn't help when we're looking at doing our measurement date on a day that there's an actual negative return. And that has, that does happen and has happened. But
I appreciate that, you know, over time it's going to fluctuate. It seemed really bad in what should have been a really good year, from my perception. And my perception may be off because I'm a lawyer, not an investor manager. So, but it seems like everybody else seems to be flying mm-hmm. gangbusters, and we're doing negative numbers.
It was not a good day. That measurement day was not a good day for anyone.
I mean, if I looked at the Dow a year ago from that measurement date, is the Dow off?
The investments, I don't know, if they would probably track closer to the S&P, but
okay.
It's higher than it was on that particular day. And the markets have definitely done better in the past 12 months, in the past 8 months, 9 mm-hmm. months. So they definitely have done better.
Is our measurement date? What was the measurement dates?
It was April 30th, because that's the end of our fiscal year. So they have to take a snapshot on that particular day.
4:30 of 17 or 4:30 of 16?
4:30 of 16.
Okay.
And our next one will be 4:30 of 17.
Gotcha. Okay. Thanks.
Okay. Trustee Wagner.
Yeah. Just jumping to the administrative tab. And I'm just looking at service goals for fiscal year 2018. Maintain the senior citizen cab subsidy program. I know that some businesses, specifically car dealerships, have accounts with Uber. Have we ever looked into that? I mean, are we actually subsidizing people using cabs?
We are subsidizing folks, seniors who use the cab program. And the cab program is, not everybody may be aware of this, so I'll just take a minute to explain it for folks at home. For senior citizens who are residents of Villa Park, they come in, they get a card from the village that says that they are seniors in the community. They can call the cab company, and they can go for rides from within Villa Park to another destination in Villa Park. And they pay, I think, $1 per trip.
Okay.
And then the cab company tallies all that up, and at the end of the month they send us a list of all of the trips that they took, and we subsidize the trip. So the cab company gets their full fare, it's just that the village pays for that. So it's an opportunity for the seniors in town to go to businesses, go to appointments that may be in Villa Park. So there's a benefit to the community. The businesses, it's a benefit to the residents. There are some limitations. It can't be a round trip, so it would be two separate calls. You'd have to come in and go do your shopping and then call again. So I know that may not be always convenient, but we don't want to pay for cars to sit and wait for business to be transacted. But so there is this program, and that is how the subsidy works. I
know there are Uber and Lyft drivers in town, and I'm just wondering if we could provide the same level of service, but by saving some money.
We have not looked at that, and that is definitely an interesting idea, and we will put that in the hopper as one of the things that we contemplate.
The other thing I noticed, Madam President, is that we do have our contribution to the DuPage Senior Citizen Council in the
yes.
budget.
Yes.
So I appreciate that.
Yes. Thanks to staff for including that. They rely on every penny of that, so yes, thank you. Anybody else?
Your Honor, I think Bob has one.
Oh, I'm sorry. Do you have one more?
Yes.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay. I'm so sorry.
It's still in administration. Also in fiscal year 2018 service goals, move forward with seamless docks to improve functionality and efficiency. Are seamless docks like Google Docs? Is it? No. Mm-hmm. What are seamless docks?
Sure. Go ahead.
Thank you, Your Honor. Seamless Docs is an organization that will take a form that you have to print and fill, and they will make that fillable on the website. So our plan as staff is to take, say, the special event application, if it's approved this evening, and give that to Seamless Docs. Within probably 30 seconds, they'll turn that into an online fillable form. So you can fill it out online and then push submit, and it'll come to staff. So you don't have to print it out. You don't have to print it out and then drop it off. And then for an efficiency on the back end, we can click certain tabs that it's mandatory to fill out, mandatory to attach certain forms. And until you do that, you cannot submit, which will save staff time, save telephone calls. So that's Seamless Docs.
Thank you.
Okay, you good? Okay. Anybody else? Any questions? Trustee Ayala?
One last
looks like you have questions. Yeah.
What I'd like to see, this budget is essentially done, so I'm not looking to change this one. Going forward in future budgets, what I'd like to see is a combination of two things. One, that these excess funds that we have available in other account balances get moved to fire and police and our pension funds. That in addition to that, in exchange for that, that police, fire, and IRF employees temper their need for adjustment of their income and salaries so that we can get that thing back up around 70% where it at least needs to be without any investment profit at all. And then hopefully the profit can get us to 80 something, would be nice to see. And it might be unique for the state, but we need to get to 80%. It should be more, but 80 is, at least apparently that's a, seems to be a going fairness. So I would impose upon staff to achieve that result. I don't know how the hell you're gonna do it, but I'd ask everyone to cooperate for that goal. That's it. That's my last comment.
Okay. All right. Anybody else? Trustee Wagner.
I'm in the finance tab, and this is under last year's or this current fiscal year accomplishments. Implemented whistleblower protection program. Can you explain briefly what that is?
Sure. Several grant programs, federal grant, state grant programs, want organizations to have a whistleblower protection. What that is essentially informing or making available to employees throughout the organization, give them an avenue for if they were to see something that they don't think looks right, give them an avenue where they can communicate with somebody who is either not their supervisor, not their department head, or somebody outside of the organization, if they see something that looks funny, that shouldn't be happening, whether it's financial or otherwise. So throughout the organization, we have signs in community areas of the village and every bulletin board in that type of area. People can contact either the village manager, me, the police chief, or our auditor directly. So we've got direct contact information for all these individuals. And also indicating that as a whistleblower, there's some federal protections for those individuals that do that. So reminding folks that there are protections under the law for that. But that's an important component of these grant programs because they want to make sure that we're being run out efficiently. We have a single audit that shows us that when we have certain grant thresholds. But also that if folks are seeing something that doesn't look right, that they have an opportunity to say something without feeling that they're going to be retaliated. So they're going to feel free to do that if they do see something. So we did implement that, and that has been rolled out throughout the organization.
Okay. Also still in the finance tab, our human resource manager, is that Janet Gorman?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Okay. And then I was just, something that just kind of stood out to me, treasurer stipend and budget officer stipend. Mm-hmm. Who are those stipends? Do you receive those stipends?
I am the treasurer, and okay. Vitas is the budget officer. And
okay.
Every month when we send the treasurer's report, he is the one who goes through it with a fine-tooth comb.
Gotcha. Okay. That's all I have for now.
Good. Okay. Anybody else? I just have a quick question. On page 7 of the introduction, under corporate fund revenues by category, grants is a line item there. It looks like we're way down on what we have received in grant funds and what we project. Is that because of what's happening on the state level and federal too?
That is definitely part of that. So I was just working with our police department today in the past few weeks to submit some additional grants. And one of the questions they had was, we're not going to get our money from the state. Why are we doing this? Mm-hmm. Well, for this particular year, there are some of the dollars that are in arrears coming towards us.
Yeah.
So there is some of that. We do get granted the money, and it's just a matter of sometimes the payments are in the long queue. Mm-hmm. And some of these grants, it's not like a direct pay with the sales tax money. Mm-hmm. It is in the direct, it's in the queue. So it's a prioritized spend from the comptroller's office. So there's some delay there.
Okay. I know each department pretty much relies on grant funding to a certain extent, you know, whenever we can go after a grant and obtain those funds. So.
Right. We look at grants occasionally for operational purposes, like the police department, they do special details with these particular grants we were talking about. For any capital need where there's any program that might qualify, we got a program that might qualify under this grant program, mm-hmm. we're investigating that and making sure that if it's even close, we're putting in for it so that we can grab those dollars to make our dollars, our tax dollars, and our revenues go a little bit further.
Right. Okay. Anybody else? Oh, Trustee Wagner.
On page 21, still in the finance tab, on that big bar graph, so there's a dramatic change in fiscal year 2030. Is that when, that's when the North Avenue TIF goes away, is that correct?
That's when those bonds will be paid off.
Oh, I see. Okay.
Yes. Yeah.
And then on page 23, the line item for the golf course, under
down at the bottom in the grade section.
Yeah. This is just explain that number to me. Is that a deficit that we owe? Is that?
Where it says golf course revenues?
Golf course total under debt service fund totals by source.
Okay, so what this is, these are a list of all of the debts all of the debt issues that the village has outstanding. So I try to categorize them by payment source or funding source. I start with property tax funded debt, and then I go on to other things. And one of them is debt certificates that the village has issued for improvements that were made at the golf course.
Okay.
And so at the end of every calendar year, the golf course looks and sees, okay, do we have enough money to pay back the bonds? Because we front the payment. Elmer's Park District also has a similar size debt service payment that they front. And at the end of the year, in about November or December, they say, yes, we have $250,000 to pay towards our debt. So they give Elmer's Park District their share, and then they give us our share. So you essentially repay us for the debt payments that we've made throughout that year. So that's what that's tracking.
Okay.
I want to make sure he's got all of this. Are you good?
Yeah. I'm kind of going
that's
through.
Okay. It's okay. I want to make sure that if you have any other questions, we can get to them. So in the meantime, does anybody else, as we're sitting up here still talking about it? A lot to absorb. We appreciate the efforts of the staff to put this together and to make it every year it gets a little more readable, a little more,
we hope for.
Yeah, civilian friendly. You know, it can be a tough document to read through, so.
We try and make it so if somebody's interested in this specific department, that section available is available by itself on the website. If you want a big picture overview, mm-hmm. we've got some financial summaries. You can just look at that summary for about 5 or 6 pages and get a snapshot, trying to make it as user-friendly as possible. And the proposed budget that you see in terms of format and information in the summaries is about what you would see in the final document. So we try to do a lot of the work on the front end to make sure that it's understandable when it's in the proposed budget format. Right. So it's ready to go in a couple of months.
It's nice to see our revenues going up because of the sales tax revenue, you know, with the economic development. I mean, it's happening all over town, and I know the residents are noticing, so, and we do too, so Thank you.
That definitely makes a difference.
It does. It's taken a long time to get to this point, especially on North Avenue and getting some of the village parcels sold and redeveloped and that type of thing. So it's been a long, long, hard road. So it's nice to start seeing some of the fruits of the labor here. So are you good? Want to make sure?
I'll defer my question.
Now's the time if you want.
Okay.
Yeah, if you have a question, now's the time to do it.
Let's see what Tim on here.
Yeah, this is all about the operation, so I want to make sure all the questions get answered. What tab are you in now?
You know, Madam President, I have a lot of questions, so I'll defer these until maybe I can visit with the manager
okay.
and get those questions
okay,
answered.
Okay, if you'd like to do that, then. Yeah. All right, great. So we'll make sure you had a chance to do so if you wanted to. Okay, that. Anybody else? I think we are good then. Okay. Our next budget meeting is this Wednesday, is that correct?
Yes.
Wednesday, that would be March 15th. And what time and where will that be?
6:30 right here.
Okay. So we're going to get into the infrastructure and capital improvements on that evening. So, okay, great. Thank you. I think, is there anything else you want to add?
The proposed budget is available on our website right now.
Perfect.
So it's in the finance department section, okay. Or I think it's in the transparency center as well. So if people want to take a look at that.
Perfect. Thank
Ready
you.
Ready to be you.
Thank you very much. Yeah. For evening reading pleasure. So there's lots there.
Yeah,
so.
I expect everyone to be reading.
Oh yeah, it's taken a while. I haven't quite gotten through all of it yet, but I'm determined. So, all right, great. Thank you for that. Really appreciate that very, very much. Okay, item number 6 on the Committee of the Whole is consider a resolution of the Village of Villa Park, DuPage County, Illinois, authorizing the proposed swimming pool season pass rates and daily admission fees for the 2017 pool season. Manager Keener?
Thank you, Your Honor. Pool pass rates must be finalized by a resolution and approved by the Village of Villa Park Board of Trustees in an effort to increase the likelihood of achieving self-sustaining aquatic facilities. The Village raised the season pass rates by 10% in 2013, 2014, 2015, and by 5% in 2016. No increase is being requested for calendar year 2017. Staff requests the rates and fees remain the same as the 2016 rates and fees. So, Your Honor, the residents ages 3 to 59 for the season pass, the dealer bird discount rate will be from May 1st to June 6th. The proposal is $53. After the June 6th time period, the regular season rate would go to $72. Non-residents age 3 to 59 are not the discount rate is not applicable to them, so their season rate would be $99. The resident senior, age 60 plus, their early bird discount rate would be $48 and $64 for the regular season rate after June 6th. Non-resident senior age 60 plus, their regular season rate would be $92. They do not qualify for the early bird discount. The daily admission fees are recommended to be $7 for residents ages 3 and older, and $9 for non-residents ages 3 and older. The evening discount fee will be $5 for residents and $7 for non-residents beginning at 5 p.m. These fees are comparable with neighboring communities with similar aquatic facilities. Thank you, Your Honor.
Okay. Any questions or comments from the public in regards to this item? Seeing none, questions and comments from the board? I just have one quick question. Since we're not raising the rates, which is a good thing, there's Greg right there. I just want to make sure that we're going to continue to cover our costs associated with operating, maintaining the pools. So by maintaining this, and I don't know, Greg, if you want to come up to the podium so our folks at home can hear you and see you. I ask this question every single year. just want to make sure that we're going to be able to properly, you know, have enough funding coming in to help properly maintain the pools for as long as we have these pools.
We're planning on it. It's all weather dependent as well, and hopefully we have a really nice May, excuse me, because that usually spurs residents to get their early bird passes. Okay. Last year we had a kind of a rainy May, so passes were slow, but they caught up in June.
Okay.
So, yeah, the pool pass rates and the dailies will hopefully offset the costs of our expenses.
Okay. So if we don't have a decent May, we still have a plan to make sure that everything will be covered properly.
Yeah, well, we're still hoping for a warm weather. It's just it's a good start to the season if the weather is good in May.
Right.
And if it's warm, the residents tend to come out and get their pool passes
sure.
early.
Sure. Yeah, just hope everything will be covered appropriately. So, not that I'm advocating for an increase by any means. It's not about
that. We're
trying
to give
all
the residents
sure.
a little bit of a break this
yeah.
year. We've raised the fees for yeah. several years.
Absolutely. So, I know our pools are maintenance hogs, as we've discussed
yeah.
many times.
Fortunately, we've been able to get some additional funding to cover some of the costs that happen when a pipe bursts or something of that nature. So.
Yeah. Okay. All right. Okay. That was all for me. Just want to make sure there wasn't any other question that came up. Okay. Do roll call vote.
Okay. Trustee Case?
Yes.
Trustee Cazone?
Yes.
Trustee Wagner?
Yes.
Trustee Taglia?
Yes.
Trustee Aiello?
Yes.
Trustee Bolthus?
Yes.
President Bullwinkle?
Yes. Item number 7 on the Committee of the Whole. Consider resolution of the Village of Villa Park, DuPage County, Illinois, authorizing change order number 3, which is the final, to the contract between the Village of Villa Park and Chicagoland Paving Contractors Incorporated for the 2016 Street Improvement Project for a deduction in the amount of $200,657.15. Manager Keener?
Thank you, Your Honor. The Village has a contract with Chicagoland Paving Contractors, Inc. of Lake Zurich, Illinois for the 2016 Street Improvement Project. The proposed final change order number 3 consists of the final balancing of contract quantities as measured in the field. The net amount of proposed final change order number 3 is a deduction of $200,657.15 for an adjusted final contract amount of $1,459,948.52. Thank you, Your Honor.
So the types of change orders I like. Any questions and comments from the public in regards to this item? Okay, seeing none. Questions and comments from the board? Trustee Aiello.
This $200,000 reduction, is this money tied to the road referendum money, or is this tied to our regular road construction plan? Yes to which question?
Yeah. Oh.
It's allocated? Do you know how much?
Vetus, you want to come up to the podium? Sorry, we got to, folks at home can't hear you or see you. Helps them follow along.
Do you know how much is allocated to the regular non-referendum?
I'd have
account?
To send that information out.
Okay.
And have it memorized.
With that kind of savings, couldn't we just move that? Let's say it's 50 grand. Can we just move that 50 grand over into the pension fund?
I don't think you can do that with street improvement.
Yeah.
No. That's right. Street improvement comes from a particular tax.
Right. All
that's
the
right.
funds for these
right.
projects come
yeah.
from.
Disregard that question. Strike that from the record.
Good try. Good.
It's a romantic notion. It would be nice.
I forgot that came from a source.
Yeah.
Damn.
Anything else? You
nope.
good? Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Anybody
yes.
else?
I almost apologize to you.
Okay. Now roll call vote, please.
Trustee Cazone?
Yes.
Trustee Wagner?
Yes.
Trustee Taglia?
Yes.
Trustee Aiello?
Yes.
Trustee Bolthus?
Yes.
Trustee Case?
Yes.
President Bullwinkle?
Yes. Item number 8 on the Committee of the Whole. Consider an ordinance of the Village Villa Park, DuPage County, Illinois, amending the fees and establishing a special event permit. Manager Keener.
Thank you, Your Honor. Presently, applications for various events are processed in different village departments through different applications. During the Village Board meeting held on February 27th, the Village Board supported the use of a new special event application packet, which combines all applications for various request events into one coordinated packet. This new packet amends the daily liquor license fee to $75, amends the raffle fee to $10, and lists other applicable fees, provides improved coordination, tracking, and planning, and gives departments the time necessary to assure a successful event that promotes a positive reflection upon the Village of Villa Park. Thank you, Your Honor.
You're welcome. Any questions or comments from the public in regards to this item? We do have a resident approaching the podium. Hi, Cheryl. State your name for the record, and we'll
Cheryl
give you 3 minutes.
4334 South Cornell. Is there a fee? I was looking at that, an original fee just to get a special policy. I noticed there's a late fee of $150 if you don't do it. Is there an initial fee for them to file without it?
I'm sorry, I don't understand.
With the application, is there a cost for the special permit?
Well, through the application, if they need barricades, it's an additional fee and things of that nature.
Right, there's a list of the fees for what it is, but is there a fee if you don't need any of the special stuff on it? Is there an initial fee that has a fund that has come in initially with the application, other than the late fee if you do it less?
I believe there is. So Jan's shaking her head. Jan, would you like to come up?
Hi, on behalf of the special event permit application, the application fee itself is $75, and anything else additional support that they need from the village is then listed in the fee schedule.
Okay, so the fee schedule is somewhere.
It is.
Right, in the on the packet.
Mm-hmm. Or is it just in the package that you pick up?
It will be available once it's approved.
Once approved on the website and with all those extra things in?
Absolutely.
Okay.
Right.
Yeah. Is there a reason we went from $30 to $75 for the liquor?
We looked at a number of other packets with other municipalities, mm-hmm. and we went with a general what other municipalities were charging. So in many cases, the village gave away all these added fees for free. So we are, for the very first time, charging for some of them and then bringing them to the area norm on others.
So we're matching other things. Same thing with the raffle. The thing that went from $5 to $10 all of a sudden.
$10.
And in the packet, it's page 11 of 13. So when it's on the website, the fee schedule will be on page 11. Okay. Any other questions from the public in regards to this item? Okay, seeing none, questions, comments from the board? Okay, roll call vote.
Trustee Wagner?
Yes.
Trustee Taglia?
Yes.
Trustee Aiello?
Yes.
Trustee Bolfus?
Yes.
Trustee Case?
Yes.
Trustee Cazone?
Yes.
President Bullwinkle?
Yes. Item number 9 on the Committee of the Whole, consider an ordinance of the Village of Villa Park, DuPage County, Illinois, authorizing the sale by public auction of vehicles owned by the Village of Villa Park. Andrew Keener?
Thank you, Your Honor. As noted in previous weekly correspondence, staff intends to purchase a used ADA accessible bus from NESRA for use by the Parks and Recreation Department to transport program participants. The current 12-passenger van, vehicle 245, utilized by Parks and Rec, is not ADA accessible, and as a result of the purchase of the NESRA bus, the gray van is not needed. Vehicle 135 is a surplus vehicle, police vehicle in disrepair and is being replaced by a new police vehicle. Staff requests approval of the Village Board to sell both vehicles on the open auction internet site. And Your Honor, proceeds from the sale of vehicles will be placed in the equipment replacement fund and used to purchase additional equipment. So vehicle 135 is a 2009 Ford Crown Vic. Vehicle 245 is a 2002 Ford Econoline 350. Thank you, Your Honor.
Okay. Any questions and comments from the public in regards to this item? Okay. Seeing none, questions and comments from the board? These auctions come up periodically, and 1 year, if my memory serves me right, and I know I'll be told I'm not right, around $70,000 of revenue was raised through the auctions by dumping these old vehicles. Is that about right?
Another surplus, yes.
Another surplus, so getting put back into the equipment replacement fund. So, okay. We'll do roll call vote.
All right. Trustee Taglia?
Yes.
Trustee Aiello?
Yes.
Trustee Bolfus?
Yes.
Trustee Case?
Yes.
Trustee Cazone?
Yes.
Trustee Wagner?
Yes.
President Bullwinkle?
Yes. Item 10 on the Committee of the Whole, Consider an ordinance of the Village of Villa Park, DuPage County, Illinois, approving and placing the 2017 zoning district map on record. Manager Keener.
Thank you, Your Honor. The 2017 zoning map includes changes resulting from recent annexations, rezonings, and other miscellaneous items. Following approval, the map will be added to the village website. Thank you, Your Honor.
Thank you. Any questions or comments from the public in regards to this item? Okay, questions or comments from the board? Trustee Aiello.
I actually move to postpone this vote. I would like to take a better look at that map.
Do you have specific?
So I move to table this item 10.
Well, before you do that, I was going to ask staff to maybe explain it a little bit more.
Sure.
In case, I don't know if that'll answer your questions, but if that's okay first, if I could.
Absolutely.
Then maybe that'll help. If not, consider that. So, Patrick Grill, our Director of Community Development, you can kind of guide us through how
yes.
this came to be and why this came to be?
Well, from time to time, there are various changes made to the village boundaries and to village zoning, and the map needs to be updated to reflect those, and the village board needs to approve those changes that are made to the map. In particular, there were zonings along North Avenue, particularly related to wildfire, that were changed. There was a property on Hill that should have been rezoned manufacturing years ago, and it never was. We did that this year. There were annexations both north of the Target and on South Villa Avenue and over on Villa and Euclid that need to be now included on the zoning map and zoned as R1. Those were included on this, and so the PUD over off of Park that had seemingly been in existence for a long time, but we researched that, that actually was never built, so therefore it defaulted back to the original zoning. We changed that back to the original zoning. So this particular zoning map reflects those changes.
Okay. All right. Hold on a second in case there's anybody. Any other questions? Well, we have Patrick.
Understood. Good. I'd like to renew that motion to
okay.
table that item 10. And if everyone's comfortable with it, I'd have to vote no. But for now, I would like to have that motion considered.
Okay. Do you want to put a formal motion on the table then?
That would
and
be the
we'll
motion.
See what
motion
happens.
To table item 10.
I'll second the motion.
Okay. All right. And we'll do a roll call vote on Trustee Aiello's motion.
Madam President?
Yes.
May I just ask a question?
Absolutely.
Why would we table it? I mean, the map is in the packet.
It's
I mean, I
discussion.
I found it was a little hard to read, you know, but I kind of trusted staff that it's accurate. And what is it that you are questioning about the map?
I haven't looked at it yet.
Okay.
We have a second, so we'll go through the motion then, and then we agree, if we don't, we don't.
All right, ready?
Yes.
Okay, Trustee Bolthus?
No.
Trustee Case?
No.
Trustee Cazone?
No.
Trustee Wagner?
No.
Trustee Taglia?
Yes.
Trustee Aiello?
Yes.
President Bullwinkle?
No. Okay.
On the main motion.
Then we revert back to the main motion in the event we don't have any other questions.
Okay.
Trustee Case.
If we wanted to change this in the future, could we?
Yes, we can.
Okay.
We can amend, and amend if we want. So.
Good enough.
Mm-hmm. Okay. All right. Now we're going to go for a roll call vote on item 10 as it stands.
Okay. Trustee yes. Bolthus?
Yes.
Trustee Case?
Yes.
Trustee Cazone?
Yes.
Trustee Wagner?
Yes.
Trustee Taglia?
Yes.
Trustee Aiello?
No.
President Bullwinkle?
Yes. Okay. And it moves forward then. All right. Speaking of moving forward, we are going to convene to the formal agenda now. Okay. Do some quick paper shuffling here. All right. Item number one on the formal agenda is the Village President's Report. I always start my report with asking the staff for updates on things that are going on in the village. We have lots going on, and so we're not going to let the snow stop us. We've got Vitas Driscalis, our Director of Public Works approaching the podium, going to give us some updates on the capital projects going on.
Actually, the snow did stop us.
Did it? Come on. Seriously? It stopped
South,
the park?
South Michigan Park the Master was supposed to start today. Obviously, they won't be starting until the snow melts. Hopefully later on this week.
Yeah, it's supposed to.
So it's just a minor delay.
Okay.
Central Boulevard Improvement Project is out to bid. That bid opening is scheduled for March 28th. The South Summit project, that's a federally funded STP project. IDOT has awarded that contract, and a pre-construction meeting at IDOT is scheduled for March 23rd. So I'm assuming we'll be starting probably about 30 days or so after that.
Okay.
North Side Sidewalk construction is expected to resume in April. The Washington Green Infrastructure Project, we're in the process of finalizing the plans, and we should be able to schedule the public information meeting on that very shortly, hopefully in the next 2 to 3 weeks, prior to going out to bids on that one.
And that'll be with the residents of the...
Washington and on Grant.
Yes.
Both together.
Wonderful. Perfect.
And actually, some of the residents on Washington were at our informational meeting last week, so they could get a little bit of a preview.
Very good. Very good.
2017 Street Improvement Project is, we're looking to award that contract in May, so we should be advertising that one in the next 30 days.
Okay.
Jackson Pond Design, we're going to be setting up another meeting with School District 45 to go over alternatives for disposal of some of the excess materials, hopefully to rebuild some of the adjacent ball fields and save some haul-off costs. Design of the Michigan project continues. We did get our first submittal from the design engineer, so reviewing that. And finally, St. Charles Road, we received, I think, 5 engineering proposals, so we're reviewing those. And we did get a go-ahead from IDOT to submit for the funding agreement, so we do expect 80% funding for that project.
And that's for the bridge?
Well, that's for design of the bridge.
Design of the bridge, okay.
So,
for reference.
So we have a verbal approval that they will pay 80% for the design of the bridge.
Wow, okay. Get it while it's hot. Okay, all right, great. Thank you for that update, appreciate it. Just a couple other really quick things. Just another reminder about the holiday light removal. We have until Monday, March 27th to remove the holiday lights from the exterior of your home, so, or building. So please be sure to do that. Also, just wanted to bring to everybody's attention, in case you haven't done so already, the Village has recently started an e-newsletter that goes out every month. That's in addition to our quarterly Village Matters newsletter. And there's a slew of other things that you can sign up for to stay in the loop on things. You can like our Facebook page, you can submit your email if you're comfortable doing that to receive updates on all that's happening in Villa Park, including the e-newsletter and other things that are taking place. So if you're interested in doing that, if you haven't already, you can go to our website, www.invillapark.com. There's a Notify Me tab. Click on that and just follow the prompts and sign up so you can stay in the loop. It's just another communication vehicle that we've brought to you over the last few years to help you stay in the loop. So there's a lot going on, so I would encourage you to do that if you're comfortable with that. And then finally, just wanted to mention that the VFW is going to be sponsoring a St. Patrick's Day dinner. It's actually on Saturday, March 18th, the day after St. Patrick's Day, but it will be at our VFW at 39 East St. Charles Road from 4 to 8 p.m. Dinner will be $10 a person, and so if you haven't had enough corned beef and cabbage, head on out to the VFW on Saturday, March 18th from 4 to 8, and support our VFW. If you have any questions, you can call them directly at 630-834-5051. That concludes my report and little updates. Item number 2 on the formal is public comments on agenda items. This is in regards to items 4 and 5 on the formal. If you have anything on your mind, you can come forward and ask us questions about items 4 or 5. If you have a non-agenda item, your opportunity is item number 6 on the agenda. So this right now is just agenda items on the formal. So, hi, Cheryl.
Hello there.
How you doing?
I have a question. Before you approve this tonight, have you guys resolved the issue that one of the residents at 583 South Harrison had expressed on the flooding and concern he had on them redeveloping this area, that the roads weren't going to be properly marked from this development company, and that the flooding was going to cause more damage to those houses there. Did you resolve that issue yet?
We have had a number of meetings, both with the residents and with the developer, and I don't know if we want to get into that now, or there's an item on the agenda where we can get into that. It doesn't matter to me.
You're
going to
be approving that on item number five, so you're approving subdivision. Hasn't got it up to standards before you approve it?
There's been lots of meetings, but if the manager or Director Descalis, whoever would like to fill in the blank here, but yeah, to answer your question, we've been working really hard with all parties involved, so we can talk about it now, sure. It's a hot topic. It's a real important topic to cover. So,
We did have a meeting with the developer, his design professional, staff, and a couple of the elected officials last week, and we agreed on language to be put on the preliminary site plan that acknowledges the existing conditions with statements that they will not make things worse during the final design of the project. So we feel we have enough written assurances on the preliminary site plan for the subdivision to go forward with the site plan.
Yeah. Okay. Myself and Trustee Aiello, we were at that meeting, and so we'll make sure we keep on top of it as we move forward. I know we have some residents from the area that are concerned, and they're with us.
The residents here today.
Yes. Also. Yes. Exactly. Right here, right now. So watching this very closely. There's the flooding in that area, as we all know, we've seen the pictures, are pretty bad. So
no, obviously, as they say, the devil is in the details. When we see the actual site plans, we'll be able to determine then if we feel they are complying with what they said they were. And obviously, if they aren't, then we would withhold permits until we do get a site plan that we feel does accomplish the intended purpose.
What's that timeline then?
Well, the timeline is pretty much in the developer's hands when they want to submit a plan. I assume they want to move fairly quickly.
I would think so.
I'm thinking they're going to want to build as soon as weather permits.
Right. Okay. Trustee Aiello, if you want to mention anything since you were in the meeting, but.
No, I think that was a fair rendition of, I think, what happened at that meeting.
Yeah.
Okay. I was at one of the meetings, too, and there's been a few of us involved in this thing, so. It's more than it's only a two-lot subdivision, which is typically just a ministerial.
Right.
So it's. Okay. Your staff's gone above and beyond what normally is done for an administrative subdivision. It's usually a simple task.
Okay. Trustee Cazone had his hand up too. So,
once the permits are in, does DuPage County have to get involved with that, or do we handle it all in-house here?
The village is a full waiver community, so we do all the stormwater permitting. And there's no special management areas involved there. There's no floodplain or wetland. So. Either way, we would have full jurisdiction.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Anybody else want to chime in while we'll be talking about this some more before it gets approved. So, yeah. This is. Sir, actually, when we get to the.
Oh, to the item? Sure.
Yes. Yes. We'll make sure you have an opportunity to speak. You've been waiting patiently. So, yes. So, once we get to that item, if you don't mind waiting, do you mind? Is that okay? Okay, perfect. I won't forget about you. Okay. But for the purposes of what's happening up here, I want to make sure so we can move forward. Looks like we're good. Okay. With that, then, I'm going to put it back out there. Are there any other folks from the community that have any questions, comments, concerns in regards to agenda items 4 and 5? Okay, I want to make sure we cover that. Okay. Seeing none, move on to item number 3, amendments to the agenda, which is the formal agenda. So anybody on the board have any amendments to the formal agenda? Are we good? Good? Okay. All right, we're going to move on. Item number 4, the consent agenda, A through I. I think in the interest of time, normally I read all the headings, but we've gone through everything pretty much in detail. So I'm going to jump ahead then and ask for a motion on the consent agenda, A through I.
Madam President.
Trustee Aiello.
So moved.
Okay, do I have a second?
Madam President.
Trustee Case.
Second.
Okay. Any additional questions or comments from the board in regards to that item? Okay. then we'll do a roll call vote on the consent agenda.
All right. Trustee Aiello?
Yes.
Trustee Bulthas?
Yes.
Trustee Cazone?
Yes.
Trustee Case?
Yes.
Trustee Taglia?
Yes.
Trustee Wagner?
Yes.
President Bullwinkle?
Yes. Item number 5 on the formal. First and final reading of an ordinance of the Village of Villa Park, DuPage County, Illinois, approving a final plat of resubdivision for the property located at 600 East Harrison Avenue, to be known as Harrison/Wayside Resubdivision. Robert Mueller is the petitioner. Petitioner is seeking a resubdivision of a single lot into two lots under the administrative subdivision regulations of the Village of Villa Park. This request meets all the guidelines of the process, and staff recommends that the Village President and Board of Trustees approve the ordinance. Do I have a motion on the first and final reading, item number 5? We'll do questions and comments, and then I'll get to you when we do the question and comments, okay? Doing a little backwards, but just want to do a motion first. We can get to the discussion.
Madam President, I'll make a motion.
Okay, do we have a second? Okay. Trustee Cazone?
I'll second that.
Okay, all right. Now, we have some questions from the community, so since we're at this item, I'd like to have you have an opportunity to come on up and speak to us, so. We can give you 3 minutes. Thank you for signing document there. Okay. And then when we get to questions and comments from the board, we might be able to answer some additional questions for you. So.
Sure, that'd be great. Sure. John Tomaszewski, 580 East Harrison. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm here with our residents as well as the McClellans, which live on Wayside, directly south of the property that's under question. And also with Scott Jones, he lives directly to the east of the property in question. And our biggest concern, as we know, the village is doing their due diligence, going through it. We greatly appreciate everything that's being done. We don't have anything that negative in that regards. Our biggest concern is that the extra effort to look at the existing water problems on the property as well as surrounding the property are carefully looked at. I was directly affected by the Fireside subdivision, which is to the west of my property. I was told at that time that there would be no grade increase. There was, and there wasn't anything I could do as a result of that. Now, I know the grade increase will increase to the east of me. It's common sense. And I just hope that everyone's looked at the pictures, has looked at the volume of water that pulls up in the area, and whatever mechanics have to be put in place to store the additional water, because that whole property, literally half of the property goes underwater, the property that's under question. And my property takes on a good chunk of it too, and now that property will no longer take on any additional water the way it is today. Just want to make sure that's taken care of, as well as to the east on Scott Jones' property. He has significant flooding. I've brought pictures in front of his house. I unfortunately did not have pictures on his west side of the property, which goes underwater as well. Other than that, I just greatly appreciate the village board to look very carefully into every step along the process and looks into the existing neighbors that are in residence in the immediate area. Mm-hmm. And that's about it.
Absolutely. Absolutely. We saw your pictures, and we see the seriousness of the flooding in that area. And that was a big part of the conversation that we had when we met with the petitioner, make sure that there was a full understanding of that. I don't know if the staff would like to add anything to that. So I'm looking at Vitas Giscalis, our Director of Public Works. He and our engineering staff in Public Works has taken a lead on this and has spent a lot of time looking at this as well.
Most of you have seen the flooding pictures. Yes. So basically what we have is we have two areas that we're calling depressional storage areas. They're areas that pond water that do not drain. So the water either has to soak in or build up to a point where it overflows in another direction. In this case, it overflows both to the north or to the south, or did at one time. The outlet to the south, some of those culverts are blocked, so we're going to either replace or clean those out and reestablish the southern drainage, but it does go into an adjacent piece of property which is outside the village. We're going to contact that property owner and see if we can work with them to get the downstream drainage to flow better, and that would alleviate a little bit to the south. We don't want to introduce more water to the north because there's already some other water issues there. So the other thing we want to make sure is that whatever volume of storage is there, depressional storage, that it is maintained. So whatever the developer has to fill in to build this house, they're going to have to replace an equal volume somewhere on their house. And we're confident that can be done because it's a fairly big lot and they can just regrade an area behind the house to replace the lost area. The other depressional storage area is in front, basically where the ditch and the culverts would be. So what we are going to do is ask the developer to put in ditches, put in culverts, and then the village would put in a cross culvert to bring that water to the south, and then it would go out of the village limits from there. So then the water would no longer pond there. So after a storm, there's still going to be water standing there. Just what our goal is to reduce the amount of time that the water stands there. Right now it's 3, 4, 5 days or more. If we can at least do some minor improvements, we can reduce it down to 1 or 2 days. At least that's our goal.
Okay.
But the main thing is the developer cannot make conditions worse. That's one of the basic precepts of the stormwater ordinance, is new development cannot make existing conditions worse. And that's the main goal.
Right. Okay. Definitely don't want to make it worse. Gotta make it better.
Let's ask questions.
Yes, of course.
I know Mr. Tomaszewski had mentioned about when they developed to the west of him with that new subdivision went in whenever it was 30 years ago.
1986, I believe.
Is there anything we can do upstream to the west to contain some of that water to delay the time it gets down into his
area?
Most
of the subdivision already drains to its own detention basin, so what drains off the detention basin is quite a drop off. So I don't think there's any opportunity to redirect any of the water just because of the steep change in grades there.
Okay.
Okay. Anybody else? Any other questions? Okay. I want to make sure that there are no other questions from the community, the residents that are here. So that are in the affected area, yeah, sorry, the affected area. Okay. Seeing none, want to make sure there aren't any other questions or comments from the board. Okay. Trustee Aiello.
Just one comment. Just, I want to make sure everyone understands that the meetings that we were talking about that were had, there was 4 engineers in the meeting, an architect, and a 30-year builder. So it wasn't, and this is a routine subdivision, so very unusual to have that kind of attention, but you got 4 engineers looking at it, so they're trying.
Yeah, I understand. I've approached the village before with the pictures, and nothing was done. You know, this is back in the early, like 2006, 2008. I came in, gave it to the village manager, the former village manager. I attended the meetings about the grants for the street project and the water project, asked, is there anything going to be done in our neighborhood, which consequently wasn't the case. So I was trying to find out, because of the ongoing problem, it just fell off the face of the earth. So that's why I'm extremely concerned. I know there's engineers and so forth, but what happens if we can't get this water to run off into the Robinette property? What happens then? They're going to put the homes there and increase the grade. And if you see, these are going to be 2, you know, huge homes plopped with 5 feet off my property line, and my grade goes down right now. It's going to go up. And just some, you know, common sense, water's going to run right down into my property again. So, you know, unless there's this elaborate pipes all over the place, which I can't imagine they would do it. It wouldn't look pretty. We got to, you know, something's got to be seriously looked at. And a solid plan, plus two huge driveways in the front. You see in the property, there's, you know, big roofs, you got the back deck, you got patio, you got so forth and so on, the square footage of absorbing water, basic science. It's got to go somewhere. So, but anyhow.
I think the critical solution for that whole area is we need to expand eastward.
We've asked about it, yes.
And I think that someday that will happen, but that's a someday problem, though. It's not an immediate solution.
Right. Yeah. So right now, here it is. You're going to approve it and move ahead. We just need your help. That's all. Thank you.
We will do everything we can to mitigate the problems that you've been having there. The pictures speak for themselves. They're pretty incredible. So we'll keep on top of it, and you keep on top of it. We'll keep on top of it together, okay? Okay?
One last thing, Mr.
Sure.
Madam President.
Of course.
At the same time, we're not fixing the problem, but the goal is to not make it worse. So let him build there. If he comes up with a design that shows he's not making it worse, it's not going to solve the problem that you have right now. Is the concern that I have for you is trying to solve that is going to be it's going to take more than what we're doing here with this subdivision. So that's got to get done at some distant point. And if that's a year from now or 5 years from now, I couldn't tell you, because there's so many other plans that have to get done right now. I don't even know where that would lay out in a budget for you in that regard. But I think it should, at least, I think with your attention to it and your attention to paying attention, I mean, you know, there's people in the room right now who had to get culverts cleaned out, and eventually that got cleaned out, and it helped. It might not have solved everything perfectly, but it helped. So if you stay on us, we'll stay on top of that problem. But I think it's going to require you to keep bothering us. North Michigan Avenue had to come in here with asphalt pieces and pieces of curb before we actually got that side of Michigan Avenue replaced. They did it for years, so feel free to come and bug us. Well,
and it's our job to stay on top of this. And we're glad that you're here, and we will continue to stay on top of this. Anything else? Trustee Case.
I've had many conversations with the builder, and he's not one to make matters worse. He's out there to do whatever it takes, not to make. He's trying to help out whatever the projects he's doing. So I feel comfortable with him working with the village. Whatever it takes, he's going to do his best. And I know our staff and everybody else will watch out. So
I'm fully reliant on what
yes.
you guys do.
Yep.
Yeah. I'm at your mercy, per se.
Okay, anybody else on the board? Okay. We will roll call vote then.
Hey, Trustee Bolthus?
Yes.
Trustee Aiello?
Yes.
Trustee Case?
Yes.
Trustee Cazone?
Yes.
Trustee Wagner?
Yes.
Trustee Taglia?
Yes.
Crescent Bowinkle?
Yes. Item number 6, then, on the formal is public comments on non-agenda items. This is an opportunity to come up and talk to us about any non-agenda item that's on your mind. Do you have anything? Seeing none, then, move on, then, to item number 7, Village Clerk's Report.
Yes, I just wanted to mention the new Village Matters will be coming out not that long. And there is a special section, I believe it's towards the back of the book, or maybe it's the very last page, but it has to do with the Senior Concerns Commission, and they are putting advertising piece for themselves regarding the senior fair that will be coming on May 4th. That is like a senior health fair. This is the third year they're doing it, and this time it will be held at the VFW. So I think it's very nice, May 4th. And also in the Village Matters will be information on the Senior of the Year nomination, and that's very important because that's announced at the event as well. So just want to make sure people are aware of that, especially the senior community. They would like to vote on somebody, or anyone in the community can vote for a Senior of the Year, but we'd love for them to attend the fair. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. All right, Item number 8, Village Trustees Report. I'll start to my right tonight. Trustee Bolthus. Okay. Trustee Taglia.
I just have to reiterate that the VFW is having a St. Patrick's Day corned beef dinner on Saturday, March 18th from 4 p.m. till 8 p.m. and dinner cost is only $13. So come out to the post and support the veterans.
Oh, 13 or the flyer said 10.
Well, line so. Wrong.
Okay. $10. And you can blame it on me if they tell you it's 13. I'm taking it off the information I got from them. Okay. $10. Okay. You good?
Yep. That's
all righty. Thanks. Trustee Case.
Yes. I recently attended the St. A's, St. Joe's, St. Patrick Day dinner. And some longtime residents approached me and asked me what was going on in this town. Mm-hmm. I said, what did you mean? They go, we've never seen so much going on in this town. She goes, can you tell me everything? I says, I don't have time to tell you everything, to tell you the truth. So I would like to direct this question to Manager Keener. If he can help me out with this. And I told them to watch the meeting tonight so they can hear everything.
Absolutely. This is where you get your updates. Yes, please.
Well, thank you, Your Honor. And what I'd like to do is I'd like to have Director of Economic Development, Jan Fiola, come up to the podium and kind of give us a summary, a brief or not, of what's been happening in economic development. I think we're well aware of all the roads being reconstructed, things of that nature, but I don't think we really talk enough about what we do in economic development and how many projects we do have coming along, whether some folks know about them or not. So thank you, Your Honor.
Sure. Okay. Hi, Jane.
Hi, thanks, and thanks for having me. I'm delighted to share all the progress that Village has made on behalf of economic development. In an essence of time, just to let you know, I did an over a 1 hour recording with Al Sash from the Cable Commission, so it's on the Village website. So that gave you a snapshot of this last year. But we also have in the Village of Matters pictures of our prominent ribbon cutting ceremonies and all of the updated, all the new businesses. But I can just go through and give you a few highlights. Over the last 3 years since I've been here, we've had 150 new businesses in the Village. Some of the highlights, Bob's Discount Furniture on Roosevelt Road, J&R Cycle came on St. Charles Road, Sir Speedy is fixing up a building on St. Charles Road, Sales Beverage World on Roosevelt Road, Keyway took a new old abandoned building on North Avenue. I could go on and on. We have three new business fitness places, Strong U near Central and Ardmore, that training for warriors on Villa, and Anytime Fitness on Roosevelt Road. So my focus is on business development and business retention. So over the years, we have had business owners meetings. All the business owners within Villa Park have been invited to attend, and we've had existing business owners share their experience with the Village. And then I've also held several developer and brokers meetings. As you know, the Village has property that was for sale on North Avenue, so I spent a great deal of time marketing that property, and happy to say that we've sold one, and it's presently under construction as Pet Supply Plus. You can see the building on North Avenue as it goes up. Also happy to say that the other property I marketed is under contract, and moving forward, it'll be on the Planning and Zoning Commission for Export Fitness. So in working to keep businesses in town, some examples, Pioneer Garden and Feed, an old business, it's been here forever. Lucky to have a young couple keep it in Villa Park. UCP Seguin is a business that was looking for a home, and it was looking for an area that wasn't really a great fit, so we found the right area for that, and then found another business to fill in an abandoned building on Villa Avenue. So we find ways to create incentives for developers and businesses. So in my time, we've created two new TIF districts, one along Villa Avenue and then also by the train station. And the one on Villa Avenue we refer to as the Kenilworth TIF. We created a facade assistance program, which would give small businesses a $20,000 grant, 50% up to $20,000. And I'm happy to say that 10 businesses to date have taken advantage of that program, and you can visibly see the improvements to their awnings, lighting, signage, painting, and we have additional businesses that I've literally gone door to door on Villa Avenue and told them about the program, and we have more that are completing their new upgrades, including the very exciting Tacom Brewery. That was one where we really helped find them the right place in Villa Park, and they are spending a great deal of time and money updating a business and bringing a really exciting business to Vail Avenue. Garden Station, just want to give you an update. That's the area around the train station. After many, many years, the developer has been unable to obtain financing, so he presently has the property for sale. And it's under contract with an internationally renowned, very respected developer. They are also challenged with the economic challenges with that. However, the Manager Keene and I, the staff, have been working with them, meeting with them on a regular basis, trying to find ways to make that an economically feasible project for everyone. So yeah, I'm a liaison to the Economic Development Commission. We brainstorm opportunities to improve the businesses, and recently we discussed having other communities come and speak to our commission. For instance, the example was Elmhurst. We've got a business owner who came from Elmhurst and said, why would people want to pay their rents here when Villa Park is so much great, great things going on, especially everything around Cortese Park. I'm working on some special projects to also increase economic development through creative ways, like the Great Western Trailhead and improvements along the Great Western Trail, coordinating with Parks and Rec, obtaining grants, working with Pride Commission on butterfly way stations. So it's a holistic effort really to improve economic development within the Villa Avenue area. So I could go on and on. If you haven't seen, North Avenue has been totally transformed, starting on the west with a new car wash. I'm excited that a new building will be delivered on April 13th. It's coming totally prefabricated. It replaced an old wash, you know, hand washing car wash. We had, you know, Bone Roofing that moved from Chicago to Villa Park. They brought many new businesses. Ingersoll Rand property sold 5 acres on North Avenue, and that's going through the Planning and Zoning Commission for retail development. Harley Davidson Wildfire developed the Event Center and Riders Academy. I'm happy to say the Junkyard also is under contract and planned for redevelopment. And then most obvious is the North Park Plaza. The developer's done a great job with the outlot building, including, you know, Chipotle, Dunkin' Donuts, Firehouse Subs, and they also are building the property just to the east of Chipotle, which will now include a Wendy's. So the whole area on North Avenue is being transformed. And what's nice, because with my background in architecture and commercial real estate my entire career, it's been nice being on this side of the table, being able to help businesses, because I knew the challenges they had. So by them coming and seeing, you know, sharing with them the opportunities that Villa Park has, it's been a real good fit to expediting them. So I could go on and on. You know, we're working with surrounding communities, Oprah Terrace, trying to de-annex and annex some very prominent properties on the village borders. So we will be scheduling our next annual business owners meeting, so look for updates on the village website and all economic updates on all of the communications that we have. If you have any questions, let me know.
Madam President, okay.
Yes.
Can we applaud?
Yes. Yeah. A lot going on.
Thank you for that update. And thank you, Trustee Case, for asking.
Thank you.
Good. We don't talk about it enough, so we're busy working. Okay.
She's going to have to watch it and watch it.
Are you good then?
I'm good.
Okay. To my left, Trustee Cazone.
Just tomorrow evening at 7 o'clock is the Parks and Rec Commission meeting. at the Iowa Community Center, open to the public, anyone's interested in what's going on with our Parks and Recreation Department. It'll be an interesting meeting tomorrow night, so there'll be a lot to discuss about the futures of our parks and some of our recreation buildings that we're talking about doing. So 7 o'clock tomorrow night at the Iowa Community Center, and I think the commission is still two people short, so if anyone's interested in being on the commission, you can approach President Ballwinkle.
Yeah, we're getting feedback on that, so.
Good.
Yes, thank you.
Okay, that's it.
Okay. Trustee Wagner.
Thank you, Madam President. Mm-hmm. I just want to mention that the Traffic and Safety Commission is meeting tomorrow here at Village Hall at 8 p.m. Mm-hmm. And they are also looking for two commissioners. Trustee Tagley and I did speak with a resident at the thing that was held at Iowa Community Center, so you may be seeing an applicant, but they are still looking for two new commissioners.
Okay, great.
I think everyone got the same letter that I did about the DuPage Senior Citizen Council and the March for Meals campaign.
Yes.
So they're looking for folks to deliver meals. This is kind of a special event there to kind of highlight the importance of Meals on Wheels for seniors. And that's going to occur on Monday, March 20th, if folks can deliver meals between 10:30 a.m. and 12:30 p.m. And I'm going to make a special effort to try and deliver meals. So
I signed up for it.
This evening, there was a special program at the library that was hosted by the library and the Environmental Concerns Commission. And the name of the program was Tour the Night Sky. And it was hosted, or the speaker was from the Naperville Astronomical Society. If you weren't able to attend that, there's going to be a follow-up to that, a program. It's going to occur on Saturday, March 25th, at the library from 8 till 9:30 p.m. And this is going to be kind of interesting. They're going to have a telescope, a special telescope. And it's kind of in coordination with Earth Hour. I don't know if folks know what Earth Hour is. It's a movement where people turn their lights off. If you go to earthhour.org, you can learn about it. And that kind of fits in with dark skies, darkskies.org. So if folks are interested and want to look at the stars, and you can visit the library on the 25th. And lastly, just want to let folks know that the St. Pius X Parish is going to host a St. Joseph's Day table. And that's going to be on Sunday, March 19th. From 11:30 a.m. to 3 p.m. And all the proceeds from that will go to the St. Vincent de Paul Society. So it's a great, great event. I think it certainly rivals St. A's, St. Pat's dinner. It's a wonderful event. And
Oh boy.
Goes to a good cause. And if you don't know where St. Pius X is, it's at Madison and Westmore in Lombard. But a lot of folks from Villa Park go there. So that's all I have. Thank you.
Okay, great. Thank you. Trustee Aiello.
Nothing, Madam President. Thanks for asking.
Okay. Item 9, Village Manager's Report. If we didn't trump it too much.
No, that's fine. Yeah. Thank you, Honor. Just want to remind everyone that we do have a special board meeting in conjunction with the Parks and Rec Commission, and that'll be tomorrow at the ICC at 7 p.m. And as Trustee Cazone mentioned, there'll be good discussion on various topics. So again, that's tomorrow at 7 p.m. at the ICC. That's a joint special board meeting in conjunction with the Parks and Rec Commission. I just want to remind everyone also that the underground utility referendum question and answer, the next meeting will be March 23rd at 6:30 at the ICC as well. And Your Honor and Board, we did send additional letters to residents in flood-prone areas to increase the attendance of this meeting. So hopefully this will be a well-attended meeting, and obviously staff believes these underground utilities need to be implemented. Thank you, Your Honor. With that, I pass.
Okay. Thank you. Village Attorney?
No report.
No report. Okay. That means we're at adjournment. Do I have a motion for adjournment?
Madam President.
Who wants to stay?
Motion for adjournment.
Okay, do we have a second?
Madam President, second.
Trustee Aiello. Okay, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Okay, we are adjourned, and our next board meeting will be here on Monday, March 27th, 2017, at 7:30 here at Village Hall. Thanks, everybody.